So my name is Ladislau Boloni. I'm a professor of computer science and I'm part of the AI Things Lab. And I'm going to talk about deep learning without big data. So little background. I guess I'm an artificial intelligence researcher who recently had done a lot of work in robotics. And I also like to use artificial intelligence in a bunch of other projects, which range from social behavior modeling to networking and sensor networks and distributed systems and cloud computing and other stuff, wherever AI can fit in, and it can fit in a lot of things. So my teaching is, I'm teaching the artificial intelligence graduate level class. I'm teaching the computer networks operating system, a couple of other projects. Okay, so let's get into the business. So deep learning is also often associated with big data, and when you see this kind of big achievements of deep learning, you are going to see this kind of stuff like image classification, and it requires 14 million labeled images, and then you have AlphaGo beats the world champion, but it does 30 million moves of self-play, and of course GPT-3, which is a big thing now, but it has been trained on the whole internet. And then here is something which reinforcement learning for robots from Google, which you can see there are 14 robots and 800,000 grasp attempts in order to learn how to pick up objects. So this is, okay. So this is a, this is an issue. And what I'm trying to convince you here is that you can actually do deep learning without having this kind of huge data sets. And there is a big, there is some good reasons why you want to try to do this. One of them is that university labs usually don't have funds like GPT-13, which was trained in $200,000 worth of compute for just one single training. And then you might have application limits, like assistive robotics, where you cannot really do 800,000 grasp attempts because the old lady won't stand there. On the other hand, there is also a scientific interest. If you need that much data, it means that somehow you don't understand where the learning data is coming from. So if you manage to learn with much less data, for instance, the amount of data which a human uses in order to learn a similar task, that means that you have understood better of what is really going on. And obviously, it's also going to have a business potential. Okay, so here is our first project which I want to talk about. This is an assistive robotics problem. The problem was that we couldn't do that kind of deep learning with a lot of data, so we decided to, first of all, use imitation learning instead of deep reinforcement learning, and second one is to do the demonstrations in a virtual environment. Most of the time people thought that that imitation learning did not work, because the general assumption was that as soon as a mistake is being made, then imitation learning is going to like veer off course, or it would just slavishly reproduce the task. And turns out this is not true if you are carefully designing your network and you carefully correct your data sets. So we use the deep neural network with long short-term memory and mixture density networks. In this project, we had used off-the-shelf vision components. And let's see how it worked, for instance. This is a demonstration. And that is the physical robot doing the same thing. And then here is another one, which is actually harder because it involves pushing the box to the right location. And you can see that it's very hard to get this one right. Even the demonstrator didn't got it right. The first time. And here is the robot. Again, clearly the simulation was not an exact match for what is happening, but look around, look how the robot goes around and corrects itself. So this was very astonishing that this actually can work like that for imitation learning. So that's how we ended up as required reading that the Berkey deep reinforcement learning class. Okay. So then the next step on this one, and I want to mention about how much data we used here. It was about 2 hours of demonstration data. So there is nowhere big data here. So next step was, what about we learn the whole thing? We learn vision as well. Previously, we used a vision, off-the-shelf vision system. Now, You would think that for this one, definitely you need big data. And it turns out you don't. You just need to carefully design your network, in particular your latent encoding. In our case, we use the variational autoencoder combined with a generative adversarial network. We took advantage of shared representations. We had to account for divergent demonstrations. So again, it's a mixture density network. And then we used the control representation must have memory. And without further ado, let me show some of these. This is how the demonstration goes. So this is for this is a demonstration for wiping the box with a towel. And this is the robot learning to autonomously do the same thing. And the same robot controller can do other tasks, sometimes very different. In this case, it's picking up that bubble wrap and putting it in the plate. And then another one is manipulating a hinged object, aligning the pliers. How much data we needed for that? 2 hours of demonstrations each, again, small data. The vision system, everything was learned from scratch. And it was a very cheap robot, $250 robot with a $10 camera and a $300 enthusiast grade video card. The trick is in the network. So now, this was our ICRA 2018 paper. So can we move forward? Well, we can move forward because there are still unsolved problems. For instance, what happens if you have an unstructured environment in which you even have some kind of adversarial entities? For instance, somebody comes and bumps you, or the robot bumps into something, or the robot drops the object, or there is clutter. And the traditional view on this one was that you just throw more data on it, right? Train it all kind of adversarial events, train against all kind of clutter and so forth. And it turned out that you don't need any of that. What you really need to do is to improve and engineer better your network. In our case, for instance, we have introduced the language command, which is like, it's gonna be like pick up a black dumbbell. Another one is we introduced a learned attention model. And then later for training, for manipulating in clutter, instead of training on clutter, what we did is that we made the network hallucinate additional objects in the frame, hallucinate the clutter. But then we had to convince the network to accept those synthetic objects as real. And so let me show you, for instance, what happens if you don't have these advances. It is, you see how the robot gets confused. Okay, it was a bit unfair to the robot, but with the new model, it tries until it manages to pick it up. And here is the same thing with the towel. Robot gets confused. But with the new model, you are going to see here a very frustrated robot. But even if you yank it out several times, it thinks a bit and then it picks it up. So it turns out that for all these, again, you do not need any new demonstrations at all. This was, again, still just the same 2 hours of demonstrations per task. There were no training on disruptions at all. There was no training on clutter at all. And again, this was just with 2 hours of demonstrations per task. So here is another project. This is our new RIPS paper from 2019. So this is image classification task. So image classification task, it used to be the assumption that you need 40 million labeled images for that, like ImageNet. But a lot of people realize that you can do it much less. And one of the ways in which people are working towards this kind of setups, which are called few-shot or one-shot learning setups, is meta-learning. So meta-learning, in particular, the one which we kind of based our system on is called model-agnostic meta-learning, which kind of fits on this learn-to-learn tradition. So you first pre-train, meta-train on something, and then you introduce some inductive bias in the network such that it's going to learn faster when it's going to be facing the real network, the real task. However, in case of MEML, you need labeled data for the meta training, or not for the final few-shot learning. So again, you are back in this big data zone. So our idea was that can we do this without having labels in the meta-learning phase? So it's like an unsupervised model. So the algorithm which we proposed was is called unsupervised meta-learning with random selection and augmentation, and it basically a combination of two ideas. One of them is that if you have a large data set, and then if you are going to randomly pick two images, unlikely that you have picked randomly two images and then both images turn out to be the same class. So it's unlikely that you got two puppy dogs at the same time. So you can get, generate data by random samples, but then you will need to have in-class samples as well, and we are going to do those by augmentation. So here is a table of, let's see, a typical results on this one. Well, basically the way you want, I mean, this is a complicated table, but basically the way you want to look at it, that there had been almost like a couple of weeks ahead, there were two papers uploaded to archive, which came up with ideas along the lines of unsupervised meta-learning. It's ours and Cactus from Berkeley. They use a different way to generate these models. So we are more or less alternating with Cactus for the best unsupervised approach. We need every single other unsupervised approach. But what we need to understand here is what's the difference versus supervised approaches. So for instance, here is the comparison with memory. So for instance, in a five-shot learning on the Omniglot data set, memory achieves a 98.83% accuracy, but it used this with supervised data, meaning it had used 25,000 labels. UMPRA had achieved 95.43% accuracy, but it only used 25 labels. So that's like three orders of magnitude less data for a moderate decrease in performance. And okay, so these are the papers I wanted to present. My near-time plans is to continue working on the theory and practice of deep learning, machine learning under data scarcity, like the learning-to-learn, meta-learning, imitation learning, temporal prediction models, and so forth. And I'm always happy to collaborate and find new applications of machine learning. So if you happen to have a problem which appears to be suitable for deep learning, but you have very little data, then maybe you want to contact me, because I'm also very interested in those kind of problems. Long term, I want to, generally speaking, contribute to the general theory of unifying reinforcement learning and imitation learning. This would be like the learn from any interaction, whatever you do, learn from these kind of approaches. And I would also would like to help solve the general problem of manipulation in unstructured environment. So what we have done until now, it is a good start on this one, but there are many other problems which we need to solve. And this is a list of the people I had collaborated in the last 5 years. And I'm happy to take questions.